So, a rolling object has two types of kinetic energies. One you can associate with its rotation about its center of mass and call it the rotational kinetic energy, and this equals half I omega square, and the other is on account of the linear motion of the center of mass that we are quite familiar with, and we can name this as translational kinetic energy, and it is half mv center of mass squared. So the total kinetic energy of a rolling object then is the sum of these two. Now, energy conservation in rolling motion is no different from any type of energy conservation we have studied so far. So here, for example, if an object is rolled from a height h, we can safely say that in absence of forces like air resistance or kinetic friction, the total mechanical energy of a rolling object is conserved. That is, mgh is equal to half mv square plus half I omega square. That is, this was a potential energy which converted into translational kinetic energy and rotational kinetic energy. And therefore, you can say this also becomes a condition for identifying if the object is rolling or not. That is, if this equation holds true, we can safely say that the object is rolling. And if it slides or slips, we know that kinetic friction would kick in, and as a result, there would be thermal energy losses, and this equation will not be valid anymore. However, energy conservation will always hold true, and this equation will then have to be modified to include heat loss by putting, let us say, E thermal loss on the right hand side. So now we move on to a slightly more conceptual part of this lesson, and that is how forces play out in rolling motion. Okay, what we have learned so far is that if a wheel rolls at a constant speed, its tangential velocity omega r equals its linear velocity, that is v center of mass. And as long as this condition is maintained, it prevents the wheel from sliding or slipping at point P where it contacts the surface. And not sliding means there is no relative motion between the two, that is the surface and the wheel, which therefore can help us conclude that there is no frictional force between them, because you know that frictional force arises only when there is relative motion between two surfaces. But let us say a net force comes into play on the rolling wheel to increase its speed. Then that force results in acceleration of the center of mass and makes the wheel rotate faster, which therefore means it results in angular acceleration alpha of the wheel. And this acceleration, or rather accelerations, disturb the smooth rolling and tends to make the wheel slide at P. That is, suddenly this equation is no more true and omega r becomes larger than v center of mass. And when this happens, a frictional force kicks in at P to oppose this tendency. So let us say, as a consequence of this force, we find that the wheel is still not sliding. Then the force that is preventing the wheel from sliding would be static frictional force Fs, and the wheel's motion continues to be smooth rolling, which therefore means this condition is still holding true. Now, if we differentiate this equation with respect to time, what we get is, on the left hand side, A center of mass is this expression, and on the right hand side, dr omega upon dt is nothing but r alpha. So what we have done is connected the linear acceleration and angular acceleration alpha. So now we can also say that for smooth rolling, A center of mass should equal r alpha. Now, if the net force acts on it in a way that the wheel ends up sliding, then we can say that there is a frictional force that acts at P, and that is a kinetic frictional force. And we can therefore say that the motion is not smooth rolling, and this equation does not apply to the motion. So what really happened here is that the static force of friction kept increasing at first to neutralize the slip and reached its maximum value. Let's call it Fs max. But this force, that is Fs max, was not large enough to neutralize the force causing the slip, and therefore the wheel started slipping or sliding. And once it started sliding, kinetic friction kicked in. So to explore this even more, we could have a situation where we have wheel that is actually rotating a lot faster while rolling to the right, quite like the start of a bicycle race, which basically means that the faster rotation makes the bottom of the wheel slide to the left at point P, and as a result, a frictional force at P directed to the right opposes this tendency to slide. And as we said earlier, if the wheel does not slide, that frictional force is static in nature and the motion is smooth rolling. Also, consider a case where the wheel is made to rotate slower, as say on a slowing bicycle. We would find that one, the direction of the center of mass acceleration starts acting in the reverse direction. After all, then only can the cycle slow down. And two, as a result of omega r becoming less than V center of mass, the frictional force Fs reverses and would now point in this direction. So let us analyze the motion of a sphere of mass m and radius r that rolls smoothly down a ramp at an angle theta. And we'll take this as the x-axis. Now, what we want to find is an expression that can give us the body's acceleration down the ramp. So the first thing we do is make a neat free body diagram and label all the forces acting on the body. And we can see there are one, the force of gravity directed downwards, and its component along the ramp is Fgx is equal to mg sine theta. Then we have the normal force Fn that is perpendicular to the ramp acting at the point of contact P. And we will move this vector so that it is placed at the center of mass of the sphere, simply because when dealing with these kind of problems, we consider any mass as a point mass. And finally, we have a static frictional force Fs that again acts at point P and is directed up the ramp. And it is important to understand why this force vector points upwards. And the simple reason is that if the body were to slide at P, it would slide down only, in which case the force of friction must oppose a downward slide and therefore act upwards. So with this information, let us go ahead and write Newton's second law for the forces acting along the x-axis, and that would be Fs minus mg sine theta is equal to ma center of mass. Now, since this equation contains two unknowns, that is these two, we therefore need one more equation. Now, another thing that you should remember is that not to assume that this static force of friction is at its maximum value. Because looking at this situation, all we can conclude is that if there is no sliding, then the force of friction, that is static friction, is just about enough to make the body roll smoothly and prevent sliding. Okay, so let us go ahead and write the second equation, and we will apply Newton's second law to the body's rotation about its center of mass. And we will use a familiar equation, torque is equal to R times the force, about this point. So we can clearly see that the force Fs produces a torque R into Fs, or the static force of friction. And this should be considered positive because it tends to rotate the body counterclockwise. Then we also have the forces Fg and Fn that pass through the center of the mass and therefore produce zero torque. I mean, visually also you can see that these forces are incapable of twisting the body. So now we can write Newton's second law in its angular form, and that would be torque net is equal to I center of mass times alpha about an axis through the body's center of mass. And putting the expression for torque from this equation, we get R times Fs is equal to I center of mass times alpha. Now, what you find is that this equation again contains two unknowns, that is Fs and alpha. So we have a total of three unknowns now and two equations. But we realize that since the body is rolling smoothly, we can write A center of mass is equal to R alpha, and this helps us to relate the unknowns alpha and A center of mass. So this brings us down to two unknowns and two equations if we use this relationship. But one thing we must make note of is that here A center of mass is negative since it points in the negative direction of the x-axis, and alpha is positive since the sphere has counterclockwise rotation, and therefore we must substitute minus A center of mass upon R for alpha. So Fs then becomes Fs is equal to minus I center of mass into A center of mass divided by R square. And putting this part of Fs here, we get A center of mass is equal to minus G sine theta divided by 1 plus I center of mass upon mr square. And this then is the general equation we can use to find the linear acceleration of any body that is rolling down an incline that makes an angle theta with the horizontal. And it would be worth noting that here it is a pull by the gravitational force that causes the body to come down the ramp, but it is the force Fs, or the frictional force, that causes the body to rotate and thus roll. So if you could make mg sine theta greater than Fs max, or get rid of the friction by, say, putting oil or grease, you will have a situation where the body ends up sliding down the ramp instead of rolling.